Hey, how you doing, folks? Isn't it good to be back? Man, oh man. It was such a bummer last year when we had to cancel. And, you know, it was like, man, I was so, I wouldn't say that I was angry, but I was upset. Okay, and it's really nice to have the banquet again. Looking forward to this time. I mean, I know whole families come and enjoy this event. And we try to make it family friendly and make it worth your time. So Ebel's going to give you a great meal tonight. We got a great speaker. I don't know if you know who the Bear Man is, but he is amazing. He's got a great story to tell tonight. And we're going to have a great time right now. So we'll be hearing in from Bruce Borkovich, longtime conservation officer, has a book, and he's also going to give away some stuff as well. So without any further ado, is Bruce in the house? There he is right there. I was looking for you over there. Why don't you welcome Bruce Borkovich for us today?
Thank you. It's good to be here. My first time up to this event. I can't believe I haven't been here. Probably a lot of you know my brother Mike, Sheriff Mike from Leelanau County. So I'm the youngest of the three brothers. And Mike, John, and I were all game wardens in Michigan at the same time. And first time that we know of, Lansing did some checking, first time in the history of the United States that they had three brothers all game wardens at the same time. So we had some pretty interesting adventures and careers. Another interesting thing is after we retired, we all moved elsewhere in law enforcement. We'll talk about that in a minute. But I'm going to have to race through a lot of stories. I want to get through as many as I can. And I also want to save 3 or 4 or 5 minutes at the end for a few questions, because there's always some questions. Sometimes there are, you know, were you the dumbest son? After you hear some of the things I did and some things like that, you can't hurt my feelings. So just kind of quickly how I got to where I'm at. Mike and John and I, all brothers, growing up, we wanted to be game wardens. That was our dream. And when we were in high school talking to counselors and beginning college, I tend not to be very politically correct, so if I offend someone, I apologize, but that's the way it is. Back then, white males couldn't take the civil service test. Flat out, were denied officially by the state of Michigan, saying because you're a white male, you can't take the state civil service test. So we all went into other careers. Mike kind of dug in hard, and he worked for DNR Parks Division, and he stayed with it, and he's the first one to get hired. I became a teacher and coach in the Everett schools. Any Everett people here? Yesterday we had a couple. I was a teacher and a coach for 4 years. Finally, took the civil service exam. Why not? Did well, and in 1986 got hired as a game warden. So by then, Mike and John were already working, and there became three of us. So just a little bit about how we grew up and what led us into the profession. Some of my best stories were from a cottage we had up in Greenbush on Lake Huron. And I remember as a kid, now this would have been in the late 60s, I had the first exposure to a game warden was an old timer named Ivan Keston. And he was down in Genesee County, and he was larger than life. We had heard of him. He was like Paul Bunyan or something, like a mythical figure. And we were out fishing at the Holloway Reservoir, and we saw him. And it was like, I was too in awe to even speak. I'm just looking at him. And I do remember, again in the late 60s, he had a pearl-handled revolver, which I'm sure the state of Michigan wasn't too happy about, but he had a pearl-handled revolver, and he was Wyatt Earp and Doc Holliday and everyone else all rolled into one. It was amazing. You know, just in awe of, oh, this is a game warden. And then the next exposure, Mike and John and I, so Mike's the oldest, John's next, I'm next, all year and a half apart. So I'm guessing we are 8, 10, 12 years old, something, you know, like that. And we all had 22 rifles, and there's a lot of people in here my age. It was different back then. Your kids could ride bikes without helmets, and they could be gone for hours, and they'd be okay. There weren't people kidnapping them or anything else. So we're up north, we get our 22 rifles, it's in the summertime, and along US 23, in the weeds there, at a certain point, the grasshoppers really start hatching, and there's literally thousands of snakes through there. And so we're walking, three kids, imagine that, with 22 rifles, walking up and down US 23, honing our stalking and marksmanship skills on the heads of small snakes eating grasshoppers. And we're so in tune to what we're doing and shooting, suddenly we hear the gravel popping, and we look, and it's the game warden. It's the green car with the blue bubble on top, and we're just like, you know, petrified. And he comes up, and I, what are you boys doing? And Mike was the spokesman, oldest brother, raised to be very respectful of law enforcement, especially the game warden, you know, larger than life. Shooting snakes, sir. And I remember how, what an impact he made, because he took a moment to explain how snakes are part of the ecosystem, they're important, they eat this, and they're here for this, and you boys got rifles next to the highway, and there's no parent here. I really think it's time for you guys to unload the guns and head home. Now, this game warden could have found my dad, chewed him out, written my dad a ticket. He didn't. He took an opportunity to educate us. This is old school game warden. I tried to always be that. It was more important to build a relationship and educate someone than necessarily send them home with a ticket. So I remember what an impact it was. The funny thing is, 30 years after that, I was a game warden. I went to his retirement party. Wayne Blanchard was his name. He retired as a lieutenant. And I asked him about that, if he remembered. And he looked at me and says, oh my God, that was you? You three boys? Says, yeah. He says, well, I find out Wayne hates snakes more than any person in America. He absolutely is scared to death of and hates snakes. He said he wished he could have paid us to shoot every snake in northern Michigan. And how hard it was for him to, you know, to teach the lesson he did and keep us safe and send us home and tell us how important snakes were to the ecosystem. So these are the exposures, you know, that we had to game wardens, and it had a big impact on us. So I hired on, as I mentioned, Mike was on, John was on. I hired on in 1986, and started my career. But I forgot one cool story. Again, up north, near Oscoda, back then, my dad would take the three of us. I know this sounds wonderful, man, wonderful parents, drop us off at night in the evening with some firewood and some snacks and our fishing stuff. We'd go to the A&P grocery store up there and get chicken guts, and we'd get big treble hooks, and we'd catch channel catfish coming into the mouth of the Isabel River all night long. All night long, big hog channel cats. And he'd come pick us up in the morning. Now imagine, you know, parents wouldn't think of doing that nowadays. So anyhow, we were on another fishing excursion, the three boys, he dropped us off. It was in the daytime, I remember, and we were catching big yellow belly jumbo perch. Unbelievable, best eating fish there is, or sure at the top of the chain, most of you would agree. Great Lakes yellow belly perch are just amazing. And they're tied up on a stringer over along the shore where the big boulders are to stop the erosion. And there had, I don't know how many we had, but I mean, you talk about a treasure, it was something. And I look over there, and there's a seagull pecking at him. Now, I never understood as a kid, they were everywhere. We used to call them sky carp, right? Sky rats, seagulls. And we never could understand why are they protected? And my dad was a wonderful conservationist, avid hunter, and he explained that, you know, the science behind it, that it's an old mariner's law that if you're lost at sea, a seagull might be able to guide you to land, or if you're starving to death, lost at sea, or on a wherever, you could catch a seagull and eat it, save your life. And so the evolution of the law was to protect them so that you can't hunt or kill them. So, you know, we understood that, and we knew they were federally protected. Even as kids, we knew what that meant. So fast forward back to the seagull pecking at our stringer, and I was like, instant, that there was nothing in me other than I have to stop that seagull. I mean, this is terrible. Those are our yellow bellies. That's perch for the next day or two, or dinner for the next day or two. And so I picked up a stone, probably, you know, that big, not very big. I'm probably 8 years old. I don't know. I'm not very old. And remember, youngest brother. And for the other old timers in here, you knew growing up back then it was brutal being a youngest brother, right? Your older brothers terrorized you, beat the snot out of you, whatever, you know. And it was great because it made you tough, but that's the way things were. So I pick up the stone, and I'm not exaggerating. I was probably from here to the entry doors, not this door, coming into this building, and I threw it. Now, any youngsters in the audience? There's one right here. When I picked up that stone and threw it, what do you think happened? You have a guess? You? I see you trying to hide from me. No? Okay. Anyone have a guess at what happened? There's some youngsters. What do you think happened when I picked up that stone and threw it? Hit it where? And what happened then? Yeah, you got it. I hit it in the head, and it went boop, over in the water. And I'm just like my whole world about ended. Because my father was the most wonderful man. He was just our hero. And all I could think of, and he worked so hard, and he was so selfish, he sacrificed so much, and all I could think of is he's going to go to prison. He's going to federal prison. And of course, how many people in here know Sheriff Mike, my brother? Yeah. What does Sheriff Mike, and in my older, John too, but especially, what do they start doing? Oh, you are in trouble. Oh, you killed a seagull. Dad's going to prison. And I am crushed. I am absolutely crushed. They quickly transition from the scare tactic into let's make a deal. And I'm cutting deals with them. You know, we didn't have a lot of money growing up. We each had a Schwinn bike. And I had to promise to make the beds. We all slept in the same bedroom growing up for the rest of the summer, polish their bikes. I forget how many deals we cut so that my brothers wouldn't turn me in. Like, they weren't going to do that. But I was scared to death. I truly thought that that my dad, my hero, you know, because of what I did. I could throw a million stones at that same bird and never hit it. I hit it right in the head, and down it went, and it died. So we were taught, you know, rules about the nature of laws and why they existed at a young age. There was another quick story. I know this. You're going to think, you know, that younger Borkovich boy, he's not real bright. And yes, that's probably true. But it also was kind of my mindset that. I really had as an officer. So up and down US 23 along the East Coast there along Lake Huron, you've got US 23, you've got Lake Huron here, and then almost through that whole area, it's miles and miles and miles of cedar swamp. Just fantastic. And it's August, and I knew from being back there before with the family that it's loaded with salamanders. And when I was a little guy, I was just obsessed with bugs and snakes and lizards and salamanders and whatever, and it was just, I was obsessed with them. So everyone's out on the beach having fun. I sneak away somehow. Mom's got five kids. I think I was the middle kid. You know, for moms in here, you know how that is. After the first couple kids you care about, the rest of them, they're, yeah, if they show up for dinner, great. If not, they'll come back eventually. I think that's how it was. So I'm in nothing but a little pair of swim trunks, 8-year-old kid, sneak out, go across US 23 into the cedar swamp. And I've got a bucket, and I am getting the mother load of salamanders. Every species that probably in Michigan, the spotted, the Jefferson, the tiger, the red belly, the dusky, everything. And I'm getting them, and it's unbelievable. And so as I had to be out there an hour. And I think by now my mom figured out I was missing. She probably went in first, took one plate off the dinner table, and said, well, it's going to be easier tonight at dinner. But she finally came, and they're coming out to look for me as I'm coming back up the driveway with my bucket of salamanders. And all I remember, my mom said, oh, dear Lord, you know, oh, my God, and looked at me. I am covered in mosquito bites and blood. 81 mosquito bites. My brothers reveled in counting them. My mom took me in, put a bunch of witch hazel in the bathtub, and you know, put me in a bathtub, soaked me, witch hazel, I don't know what it does. It didn't make me any smarter, I can tell you that. And my brothers, you know, they're just shaking their head about the young dumb one. And 81 mosquito bites, and those are big Boone and Crockett mosquitoes in Alcona County in August, I can tell you that. But it also really kind of, was my personality style as an officer. I wanted to go out and get the worst of the worst, the people really doing the damage, and I would do anything to get them. And that particular particular story and my obsession with do that kind of it hit home with another once I became an officer in Isabella County. With another little adventure I got myself into. So we in Isabella County, there's a lake, Coldwater Lake, and it has walleye in it, and it actually has some natural production. And for the walleye reproduction, for the walleye fishermen, you know, that's not easy in an inland lake. You've got to have river fed. Generally, it did. It had a river running through it. And so it was a pretty neat deal. And I'm brand new in a county, but I know enough that I've been told that there's walleye in this, and then What happens in the spring? Walleye fishermen, the walleye run, right? They come up to spawn. So it's real early April, first couple days of April. I remember it was extremely cold, and the river, the Coldwater River, I would say, is as wide as that pew, maybe a little wider. And I remember probably 3-4 feet on each side, there was still ice. I mean, it was really, really cold. And I didn't have any waders issued to me. Eventually I got some. I didn't have any, but I'm going around the lake and I look and I know where the mouth of this is, and I look and there's like 20 people in some boats right there. That's kind of a sandbar where it empties into the lake, and I'm thinking, this is it. Those dirty, rotten SOBs are all in there catching or snagging or what walleye while they're running. The season was closed. The season wasn't open. Wasn't going to open for quite a while. And people who are doing that are really hurting the population, because these are spawning fish. These are fish running up the river to spawn. So, man, the juices are flowing. I felt just like I did when I was 8 and I knew there were salamanders across the road. So it was in the afternoon, extremely cold. I did have a kind of a short winter coat on, no waders. There's no way to get to these guys other than come up the river. Now, how many people in here have ever trapped, swam in, or fished in a river? Okay, do they run straight from here to there? No, no, back and forth and back and forth. So I get going, and I'm in probably an hour, and I realize I'm freezing. This is brutal. It's about crotch deep water with no waders, and part of it's ice. And but it's like I'm committed. I got to do this. That they're out there, you know, poaching our walleye. And I've come so far, but it's taken so long, and I'm going farther and farther and back and forth. And I'm thinking, am I going to live through this? But finally, as I'm going through, I can see up ahead, and I can see a couple people in some boats. So now I'm in stealth mode, and I'm going slow, and I'm hiding behind log jams and snags and stuff. And I've got binoculars, and I'm looking, and I can see people catching fish. I can see those big white bellies, putting them on stringers. I'm like, I'm going to be the most famous conservation officer in the lower peninsula. There's no game warden anywhere that's going to make the case that I'm making on these spawning. I'm brand new. I'm going to be a legend. This is the day I'm going to be a legend. I'll show my older brothers, who think they're really, you know, legendary game wardens. So I'm getting closer and closer, and finally I realize, okay, now I've got to go. No one had seen me yet. Now I got to go out and announce myself. So I get out there, and I top of my lungs just about, I better not, everyone freeze, I better not see one fish get tossed back. No one grab stringers, no one move. And they're all staring at me. And I'm like, oh yeah, okay, they know who the man is. Uh-huh. And everyone's just staring at me. Like literally, if an alien landed in the parking lot and walked in here, kind of what you got, you'd be just like, you know, there's an alien here. And I'm getting going up, and the closest boat is an older guy with his grandson. He's just sitting there staring at me, and I'm getting closer and closer, and I can see their stringer of fish. There are probably 20 of them. How many people in here fish? How many people in here know what else runs in rivers in the spring, early spring? Suckers. Every one of these people, we're catching suckers. And if you don't know what a sucker is, they're not protected in Michigan. There's no closed season. You can keep 10 million of them. And there wasn't a walleye anywhere. There were hundreds and hundreds of suckers, but not a walleye anywhere. And oh, I'm just like, I just can't believe it. But I got to be cool. And I got to be this great sucker protector game warden. And so I'm going, you know, I'm going to go and check each one of them and check licenses and check, you know, look it over and make sure there's no hidden walleye. Not a violation. Not one person was there without a license. Not one person had a fish they weren't supposed to. But that, I got all done, and I'm kind of walking back past that older gentleman who was the first guy there, and he looks at me, kind of nodding, and he says, kind of cold, isn't it? Yes, sir, it is. I think I was all white. I was almost in shock. And there I go, back down the river. And it was well after dark before I got back. I had never been so cold in my life. But I did have a passion for protecting the resources. And obviously, more passion than intelligence. But, you know, that passion paid off throughout the years. You know, I'll backtrack just a step. I'm a brand new officer in the county, but conservation officers are also police officers. We have to go through a police academy. You can enforce any law a trooper can. My group graduated from the police academy on November 14th. Significant in Michigan? Maybe. And I remember back then the training program was this. There were 24 of us, big group in that police academy. We got done, we had to go out and stand at attention in the parking lot, and there were 24 Dodge diplomats. There's the pinnacle of American engineering right there. 24 Dodge diplomats, the keys in the trunk, they're all lined up just like we are. We get, they read off license plates and, you know, Borkovich, license, blah, blah, blah. You go over there, pop the trunk. In it was one set of uniforms, a winter coat, a hat, a pair of boots, a law book, a bunch of ticket books, and a map of the state of Michigan. And the lieutenant says, open up your maps, open up the map, and the county that you're assigned in that's going to be home is circled. That's how formal it was back then. It's circled, and I see Isabella County, where Mount Pleasant is circled. And basically, the instructions are get in your car, go. You've got per diem for a hotel. Tomorrow's opening day of rifle season. And that was the training. Pretty intense, thorough field training officer process. So I'm there in Isabel County. There hadn't been an officer there at all for 2 years. It's the Wild West. It is literally. I remember I found this honey hole on the west side of the county, ended up becoming great friends with the landowners there. Great deer hunting, where the best deer in the county were, and ended up hunting there, but this one intersection was just crazy for several years. And I remember, I just get done with one vehicle road hunting, a couple loaded guns, and the next one comes through, and I'm in my uniform, but I got a camouflage coat on, so it's kind of hard right away to tell them. And I stop them, and windows down, it's cold, all the, you know, the makings of the road hunters, and there's three of them in there, and I see there's a lever action Winchester right there, uncased, you know, and I get them out of the truck, and there's an old timer in there, and I go to grab the gun, he goes, careful, young man, that's loaded. And okay, like these guys hadn't, there'd been no enforcement there forever. He wanted to make sure I was safe, because the gun's loaded, which you all know is quite illegal in Michigan and in most states. That following spring, it was after the first year I got there in November 15th, that following spring, a 911 call came in from near another lake, and it was a frantic young woman who called in, crying on the phone to dispatch, saying she's being attacked by a turkey, and you know she needs police, she needs help. And I get the call, and you can almost hear the troopers and deputies chuckling without being on the radio. Like, oh yeah, and I'm thinking, oh, you know, probably someone, you know, some mental issues or whatever. Beautiful spring day, and so I go out there and I pull in and I look, and there's a huge tom in the front yard. So I'm thinking, well, okay, at least there's a turkey here. She's not imagining it. And he's looking at me, and he's doing that tanking, you know, and he's kind of checking me out. I go up to the door, and a mother with two toddlers and a baby, and the baby had a doctor's appointment. She is in tears, and she's just sobbing. She's, I'm late for a doctor's appointment. The baby's got to see if you're late. You can't get in. And every time I go out, he attacks me. Well, if you're an avid turkey hunter, you know that once in a while, turkeys in the spring get crazy territorial. And this was one of them. Because as I'm talking to her, she goes, there he is, because he's coming at me now. And he doesn't care that I'm 10 times as big as him, and the game warden, he could care less. He's coming at me. Now I'm thinking, I've got to destroy this bird, because if I don't, I'm going to be answering these calls for the next week until breeding season's done. So back then, we carried these collapsible batons, so they'd collapse down. Does everyone remember the story with Tanya Harding and Nancy Kerrigan? And remember Tanya Harding hit her with a steel baton? That's the same thing. We nicknamed ours the Batanya. So I'm trying to figure out, how do I put this turkey down? It's kind of a neighborhood, didn't want to spook people with a gunshot and everything. So I'm taunting him, just like two guys on the playground. Oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah, hit me, no you hit me. And I lure him out in the woods, and he's had enough, and he's coming right at me. He isn't scared one bit. I pull that baton out, whack him across the head and kill him, and luckily it took him over to it. We had a list of some needy families that we could take deer, turkeys, or something, and they would, you know, eat them. So those are some of the crazy things you run into. You scratch your head at first and think, but you know, with wildlife, it's never say never. There was another incident. I think it was a couple springs after that. I was real close with the Mount Pleasant Police Department. Great people, wonderful people, and the chief there, great guy. The chief knew nothing about, he was not an outdoorsman, knew nothing about, you know, wildlife. Well, there was a young bear that wandered into town, a 120-pound bear, very typical in the springtime and breeding season. Big bears will beat the you-know-what out of the young bears, and the young bears will take off running. Sometimes they'll run for days. They literally could go from, you know, Houghton Lake bear to Mount Pleasant just because they keep running. And that was probably the case, young male. And he was in and out of neighborhoods just terrorizing everyone. And so the Mount Pleasant police called. They ended up calling me. And I never forget, it was a day off. I'm in plain clothes. And I'm trying to, you know, trying to figure out a way not to destroy this bear. How do we get him out of town and not destroy him? This bear's, he's not trying to be bad. He's scaring the heck out of people, but he's not trying to cause problems. And I know that the police chief had told his guys to shoot him on sight. Well, I've been around enough to know that he doesn't know what he's doing as far as, he doesn't know wildlife, number one. Number two, he doesn't know that he could bring a national story down on the Mount Pleasant Police Department from a lot of animal rights people about why they had to kill this young bear. And I'm trying to avoid that. I'm close with these guys. And I remember one point, I saw the bear run around a house. This is in the morning. So I'm going back to get after him, trying to corral him to a woodlot. We hope to get him in a tree. And just as I'm doing that, I'm starting to go around the house. A lady comes out. She's in her house coat with a cup of coffee. It's about 9 in the morning, and she's staring at me. I'm in plain clothes with a gun in my hand, and she's staring at me, and I look, and here comes the bear. Now, there's from you to you between the house and the fence and where she and I are standing, and the bear's got it. It's coming this way, and I said, look out, and I kind of push her back, and that bear came right here, and she never moved. I think that was probably, you know, 35 years ago. She might still be there. with the same cup of coffee going like that. She never moved. She never reacted. But those are the, you know, some of the crazy things you run into. I remember, so I finished my, I forgot to tell you how my career evolved. I'll do that real quick because it'll help make some sense out of a few stories. So I think I told you, shared with you that I was a teacher and a coach for 4 years before I became a game warden. Was a game warden. I retired in 2006 on a Friday. The following Monday, I went to work for a state police drug team, the Bayonet drug team. And I was a detective and the assistant team leader there to help run that team for 7 years. So from 2006 through 2013, I was on a drug team. I remember we did a little bit of math, and the lieutenant and I figured out that while I was there, we had executed at least 250 search warrants in those 7 years. So that was high speed, low drag, just like you see on TV. And then I remember one particular case, we went to an apartment complex to serve a search warrant. We would always get a key ahead of time. We had good relationships with the apartment managers, so we didn't have to bust their doors down, which cost them a lot of money. So we had the key, and I was the assistant team leader, it was my fault, so we didn't have our breaching tools because we didn't need it, right? We had the key. We go up there, put the key in, turn it, snap. This is after we've knocked, announced, police search warrant, bunch of armed guys in vests. Now it's crunch time, right? If, you know, the drug dealers are in there, are they getting a gun, ready to shoot us, who knows? So I start kicking the door. It's not like you see on TV, folks. This is a steel door in an apartment complex in a steel frame. The carpenters in here are going, oh, and I kick, and I kick, and I'm in my 50s by now, and I kick. I think I kicked that door 15 times, and it never went in. And everything is okay, no one got hurt, we finished there, but I realized after that I was probably getting a little old to do the drug work. And so from, in 2013, I left the drug team and I became the police chief at Ferris State University. Any Bulldogs in here? Oh, look at all the Bulldogs. Anything special about Ferris State University this year? What happened in football, guys? National champion this year, and unbelievable, and ironically, people could say I can't hold a job. One of the things I also did this year after I retired from Ferris is I was a volunteer assistant football coach for the football team. So I got to do it for a year, jump on board, act important, and go to McKinney, Texas, and win a national championship. So that was pretty cool. So as I'm getting on in my uniform career, back then, they allowed the uniform officers every once in a while to do some undercover work. And so I was in Isabella County. Over in Lake County, they had a couple guys that were snagging, catching a lot of salmon, and selling them. So first of all, you can't snag salmon. Secondly, general rule is you can't sell fish and game, wild fish and game. You can't make a profit off it. You can't sell them. And they needed some fresh faces to come and kind of work undercover. I had no training or anything, but a buddy of mine and I went over there and worked it. And we finally made what we call a cold hit on the main suspect, Jimmy. And that's where you just, there's no way to get introduced or anything, you knock on the door. So we knocked on the door, and I'm here to tell you, I had seen a deputy out there, I don't know if he's gonna ever do undercover work, but I'm here to tell you, who do you think is harder to fool as a police officer doing undercover work, a male or a female? Female. 10 times harder to fool. I cannot believe, through, and I did a ton of undercover work, both in the drug world, and I'll talk a little more about fish and game undercover work, and it is so much harder to fool women. They just have an instinct. I think it's they're so used to all the nonsense we give them over the years that they don't trust anything we say or do. That's probably it. So anyhow, we knock on the door, and we had a story all up that I grew up in Flint, so it was pretty easy to say, hey, you know, the guys down at the bar told me we could get salmon from you. I work in an auto shop. I can sell this stuff all day long, you know. And all he sees, he's got no gut feeling about me. All he sees is a chance to make money. His wife, sitting back on the couch, laser beams coming out of her eyes right at me. And so we're doing our introductions and making plans and talking about what's going to happen. And she finally says, I got to ask you, are you guys game wardens? And we always had, we were prepared, you know, later on when I became a detective doing undercover work, you had a lot of answers prepared. We learned it from, especially like you learn it in the drug world, as a, back in the 60s, believe it or not, drug detectives would actually do drugs with people doing drugs. And that went out years ago, that absolutely can't happen anymore, blah, blah, blah. But one of the things the drug dealers learned real quick was when you first met them and they're not sure about you, they'd offer you whether it was a joint or a line of coke or something, and they, you know, you want to take it, and you had to have answers prepared that were believable and that were plausible, and you know, you couldn't hesitate. So we kind of had an answer ready, kind of laughed her off, and she never really relaxed around us. But we take off with her betrothed. He was just a peach. She should be very proud who she married. And so we spend the day, a day and a half, he's snagging fish, and then we're buying them from him. So this is cool. You know, my first time doing undercover work, this is really cool. And the next day, we'd been there 2-3 days, we busted a bunch of people. I remember the first day we were there, we're on the Baldwin River. The river's full of steelhead and salmon. And we're down there, and we walk up, and there's guys all over in the swamp for a quarter mile. And everyone's just looking at each other. Especially us, you know, didn't recognize us. And we're just hanging around, we're looking at fish, and we're thinking, we know guys are spearing here like crazy. You know, we don't see anyone with spears. What's going on? So we figure, let's get this party started, because we had a couple spears. We go back to the truck, come back with spears, and suddenly it looks like Mel Gibson in Braveheart. There's an army of people with stuff, spears and all. They're pulling them out from under logs and trees. They had them hidden out there, and it's just a feeding frenzy out there, spearing fish. It was an eye opener for us. It was amazing. But we finally get done. It's time to bust the main guy. So the local sergeant, a guy named Mitch Babcock, wonderful guy, old school game warden. He was Sergeant Nuevo, I think. He's the one on duty in that area, supervisor, who is going to go arrest this guy. So we show up, we knock on the door, and it's myself and my partner in plain clothes, but Mitch in uniform. And he identifies himself, and he says, come on out, Jimmy, you're under arrest, you know, for selling salmon. And the wife's there just glaring at me, and she finally comes out to the door, and she can barely talk, she's so mad. Two times I asked him if he was the game warden, and he said no. And Mitch always had a toothpick in his mouth, and he goes, I guess I'll have to talk to him about that. As they're putting handcuffs on Jimmy and taking away. And what was interesting is there was a belief, there still is, in the realm of drug dealers, people doing things wrong, is that a police officer undercover has to tell the truth if you're asked. They truly believe that. You'll hear about another case I ran. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but it was, we were in a different state. I was also a deputized federal warden for U.S. Fish and Wildlife, because I was running cases in other states, and a big-time guy. He had his whole, 15, 20 seconds rehearsed speech on officially to ask me if I was any way affiliated with state or federal, you know, officer. And they truly believe that if you lied, they'd get off because you didn't tell the truth. Geez, an undercover officer not telling the truth. Go figure that one out. So anyhow, that just kind of whet my appetite, you know, for undercover work. I thought this was cool. I really, really enjoyed it. And I'll tell you a quick, I'm doing okay, a real quick story. The guy I was with, another field officer who's now a lieutenant in Gaylord, real good friend of mine, Jim Gorno. Jim was an officer, and then, once I became a detective in 99, in the special investigation section, we didn't have many detectives, so we thought we'd make temporary investigators. So they hand-selected about 15 officers from around the state that could come in on temporary assignments. So we put them through a week investigative and undercover officer school, and it was really cool. We really researched what to do. The first thing we did with all 15 of them, we brought them in. Of course, they're in plain clothes. We brought them up, said, everyone, take everything out of your pockets. Come on, put them in this bag. They emptied their pockets. Those who didn't have a quarter were given a quarter. And then they were all set, each one of them. It was up in Traverse City here. And they were all set to be dropped off 15 miles from the hotel we were at. And their job was to get back to the hotel as quickly as they can. And they, with no police ID, and they were on their honor, they could not tell anyone who they were. And we were teaching them a lesson in how to con people, how to react on your feet, how to speak on your feet. So we drop them off, and we get back. So we're 15 miles out. We hustle back to the hotel, and Jim, my buddy, Gorno, who's on this assignment with me, is sitting there out in the sun on the bench in front of the motel. We just dropped him off. We dropped him off at a car dealership, or close to it. Because what he did, as soon as we dropped him off, he went to the car dealership. There was an older couple there shopping for a car, and Jim went up to him and made himself almost teary and said, oh my gosh, my wife's up here having a baby at the hospital. The hospital was real close to where we were staying, I know that. My wife's at the hospital, and it's our first child, and I was on my way up here, my car broken down. And these old people just bought right into it, and they stopped the deal they were making, put them in the car, and raced them so fast they beat us back. So now we did have officers, a couple of them that had to get picked up, because that's what the quarter was for. After 2 hours or 4 hours, if they weren't back, they had to call us. But Jim actually beat us there, so Jim was a pretty sharp guy. I also had this, I was in law enforcement. I won't use the four-letter word, but I was a doo-doo magnet, if you know where I might be going with that. The other word starts with an S. I don't need to go any further. I was a doo-doo magnet. If something was going on, I was going to be in the middle of it or near it. I'd be out in the middle of nowhere, and there'd be a shooting somewhere that the state police or sheriff's department sent on, and I'd be a mile away, and I'd be the first one there starting to deal with it. And that's just, I don't get it. It's just the way it was. So I'm over in Saginaw County helping. That's in our district, helping another great guy, former trooper, became a game warden. And we're in his truck. His truck's really dirty, and it's got a canoe on top, and we're working road hunters, and we have camouflage coats on our uniforms, so we just look like any other people in a truck. And this is going to sound weird, but this was back when there was still a few pheasants around, and this was by the Crow Island State Game Area in Saginaw. Some of you probably know where that's at. And there was an area where people would dump their garbage, and then the animals would tear open the garbage, and there's bread and stuff in there. Anyhow, the food that might be in there, the pheasants would come in there and peck at it and eat. And what it became was a place for the area road hunters to come by, stick a gun out the window, and poach a pheasant. So we were going to go down there and make a pass, maybe even hide back and watch it for a while. So we get up close, and there's a car right there parked. And we thought, okay, that's someone who probably just shot a pheasant. We're going to make a good case. So we take them head on, and there's one person in the middle of that front seat. And finally, we're like real, like from here to you away, we're getting close to them, and I look. One person became two. There was a male and a female that were together. And so we get up there, and the male on the driver's side, female on the passenger side, we get them out. We get her out. She steps out of the car. I'll keep this as G-rated as I can, but her pants are at her knees. She's literally got a crack pipe in one hand that is smoking. I remember making sure I'm upwind of it. I didn't want crack smoke in me. She's got a bottle of black velvet in her other hand. And the first words out of her mouth, anyone have a guess? How come you ain't out catching real criminals? So for $25, we find out that they met up for a liaison. And that's a rock of crack and what they're doing together there. And so we were the first conservation officers in the history of Michigan, and probably the last, to make a legitimate arrest for prostitution. We literally arrested her for prostitution and him for soliciting prostitution. First time in history. I can't imagine it's going to be repeated. How are we doing time-wise?
We gotta wrap it up. But we've got a bunch of people downstairs. We got
absolutely
getting ready to go. So, hey, you know what? You can read all these stories. We're going to give away a couple of books here, and we've got 3 tickets that have been already drawn. So if you get your tickets out.
And by the way, this Wild Things is what I wrote. Brother John wrote Wildlife 911, both for sale out here for anyone. They make great gifts.
Okay, thank you. 403263. Pink. Sorry about that. I didn't know there were other colors. All right, all I got is 3 pink tickets, okay? So here we go. 403263. 403263. And you see that your first one, you want Wild Things, Wildlife Patrol, or the knife? Okay. Here's the knife. Thank you. All right. Let me get. I didn't mean that.
Well, maybe the other one.
All right. Next. Wildlife on Patrol or Wild Things, one of the two. Next ticket, 403235.
All right.
403235.
Yeah, I'm glad to see this. We wrote, both of these books were written very intentionally. There's no swear words. There's nothing sexual. Very appropriate for any age. And we're shocked at how many 8, 10, 12-year-olds are enjoying reading this book. So for parents, no worries about your youngsters reading this.
All right, and the next one is 403283. 403283. A winner on that. There we go. Hey, all right, everybody. Thank you for joining
thank
us
you
today. Please go over to this door over here. Please make your way over there. Thank you very much. So much, Bruce. Appreciate the stories, man.
If I could learn to tell time, I'd be good.
Me now, those chains are